The northeast region of India is one area which has always been in news for the wrong reasons. Recently, again, yet again, we saw there was a news with respect to northeast insurgency which claimed that there was an encounter between the armed forces and DNLA, which is a militant organization of northeast, which said that around 7 top DNLA militants were killed during this encounter which happened in Assam's Karbi Anglong. In this video, we will be discussing about this recent episode, and also I will be touching upon some points which we have seen historically which have created issues in the northeast. So to start with, let us first see what exactly was in news recently. So a lot of reports came which claimed that 7 top DNA militants were killed. There was an encounter that happened which also with the help of which a large cache of arms has also been recovered from these people. The photograph, you can see it here, right? Apart from that, there was a lot of stuff which was mentioned in the reports, but a lot of us are not actually aware of what exactly is DNLA. We are not aware of what exactly are the masas, who are the masas, and what is their demand. So let's first try to decode these basic things and then maybe move forward. So who are the masas? This is the main three questions. Let us answer this first. Who are the masas? What is DNLA? And what are their demands? So the masas are nothing but tribal people who have been living from generations in these areas of Assam and Nagaland. So the masa is a tribe basically, which is an indigenous ethno-linguistic community which lives in some parts of Assam and Nagaland. By the way, northeast region is one region where now currently I think around 238 active tribes are there. So the masa is one of those tribes, one of those people out of 238 which are active in northeast India, right? Apart from that, the Dimasa Kacharis belong to the Indo-Mongoloid group. They have prominent Mongoloid features. Apart from this, according to the census of 2011, the population of Dimasa Kacharis is, overall population is around 1,15,000, right? Out of that 1,15,000, around 1 lakh people live in the areas or the territories of Assam, and the remaining 14,000 to 15,000 people live in the areas of Nagaland. So two major states where we can see Dimasa population is Assam and Nagaland. Apart from this, what exactly, after discussing who are the masas, let us discuss about DNLA. What is DNLA? What does what do you understand by DNLA? DNLA is nothing but Dimasa National Liberation Army, right? That is the full form of Dimasa, DNLA, Dimasa National Liberation Army. And what exactly is their demand? So Dimasas basically want a separate nation in these areas where they live, in the areas of Assam and Nagaland. So they want a separate Dimasa nation for their people, and DNLA is an organization which is fighting for this cause. So DNLA was recently formed in 2019, right? So let us try to understand the geography of where this entire episode is happening. So when we're talking about DNLA, when we're talking about Dimasas, first of all, this is how these people look like traditionally. This is their traditional dress that they are living, that they are wearing. Dimasa people are the inhabitants of Kachar Hills Autonomous District Council, Karbi Anglong Autonomous District Council, Kachar District, Nagaon District of Assam. Essentially, what we are talking here is this particular area which I am drawing right now, Kachar Hills, some part of Kachar Hills. Then we'll go towards the north in East Karbi Anglong. We'll cover some part of Nagaon and the entire district of Dima Hasao. So this essentially is the area that Dimasas are talking about. This is the area that they want to convert to a separate country for the Dimasa people. They will cover they want to cover some part of Nagaland, they want to cover some part of Assam, and this is how they want this entire area to be made. So is this demand the first time that DNLA is proposing? No, the answer is no. Historically, in 1991, we saw the first time when Dimasa students were demanding for a separate nation for Dimasa people. So ADSU is an organization which is called All Dimasa Students Union, which demanded in 1991 for a separate Dimasa nation, and earlier they used to call it Dimaraji. So even the maps were out of Dimaraji. The entire areas which I drew somewhat is the entire area that these people want to make a separate nation for Dimasas. So historically they have been demanding for this particular separate nation, and we see similar demands erupting out of a lot of places in northeast region. Like in Assam itself, there is some part which has been, you know, about which there have been so many protests, so many insurgents, groups have been demanding for a separate nation for Bodos. Bodo land ki demand bhi kafi lambe samay se chal rahi hai. If we talk about Nagaland, Nagaland ke andar bhi we see Nagalim is a separate country which which NSCN has been demanding. So a lot of areas have been, a lot of tribes have been demanding separate nations in specifically Northeast. So the issue definitely is not new. And earlier when this issue came, there was a particular organization and outfit which was called Dima Halam Dauga. Around this time, during 1990s, there were a lot of internal conflicts between these organizations. Hence, the movement could not take pace like it is taking pace now, only after 2019, when DNLA is now formed and it is working very hard to prove put forward their demands. So if I talk about Northeast, Northeast is one such area which is full of issues, which is full, it is a web of complex issues. And let us try to discuss very briefly every point that can touch upon the situation that exists in Northeast. First and the foremost reason that we are going to discuss about is the historical reasons. If historically we look at Northeast, this particular area when was ruled by Britishers, even then this area was very loosely administered. That means the Britishers were not very active in this area. There was a lot of there was not a lot of development that was done. Only in 1835 there were tea gardens which were established in Northeast. In 1889 they found oil fields in the Northeast. Essentially these two were the activities which were done. But apart from that, in 1971, when Bangladesh was formed, the entire Chittagong port, with the help of which we were exporting or importing everything to Northeast, was taken away from us, right? There was a separate country which was formed. So historically, this has been an area which has been loosely administered. If we talk about the next reason, one of the biggest contributors to the Northeast insurgency or the problems of the Northeast is the illegal immigration. Now, as soon as the Bangladesh 1971 war happened, we saw a huge influx of population that illegally migrated from Bangladesh to the Northeast region, and most of them settled down in Assam. So people say, a lot of reports say that more than 1 crore people left Bangladesh and they started moving on foot towards Assam. So that entire influx of 1 crore people led to a lot of communal tensions, since most of the people who migrated from Bangladesh were Bengali Muslims and the people who were inhabiting or who were living in Assam were mostly tribal people. So there were a lot of issues with respect to insiders versus outsiders. So this is the other issue which surrounds the Northeast with respect to insurgency, which the other reason now we talk about is geographical reasons. If we talk about the geography of entire Northeast, we see a few things. One thing is that the entire area is mostly covered by hills, right? So for any government, it is very difficult to do some kind of development work. It is very difficult to develop infrastructure in those areas. Apart from that, if we look at Brahmaputra River, there is a constant every year phenomena that Brahmaputra floods for at least 4 to 6 months. So because of that, we see there is a lot of disruption of infrastructure. Whatever construction activity is being done, everything gets destroyed and reconstruction is happening instead of development, right? So this particular thing contributes a lot here. Apart from that, development reasons, yes, the government has not been able to develop this entire area because of sometimes lack of funds or sometimes because of geography. There are many other reasons also. The insurgents also sometimes hamper the development projects which the government wants to undertake there. Military reasons, since Nagaland is known to be, the Naga insurgency is known to be the mother of insurgencies when we talk about the Northeast. So in Nagaland, the insurgency started and immediately AFSPA was implemented in Nagaland in 1958, which was the first state where AFSPA was being implemented. And AFSPA, the implementation of AFSPA also created problems for a lot of people. And because of AFSPA also, there are a lot of insurgent groups which say that a lot of human rights violation have been done in Northeast areas, and this contributes to the problems that are there in the Northeast. Apart from this, if we look at the foreign policy that the government of India has undertaken in Northeast, have also failed. Like if we look at the Look East policy, which was implemented in 1991-1992 by P.V. Narasimha Rao, that particular policy also was a great initiative, but the implementation part was very weak. And recently we have seen that in 2014, PM Modi has also launched a new initiative, that is Act East policy. So they now, I think the government now finally realizes that Look East policy, since it was a failure, not a lot of things have been done with respect to Look East policy. Now the government has begun working on the Act East policy. Let us hope that a lot of work is being done with the help of Act East policy. Apart from that, if we look at the borders of Northeast region, we would see that 99% of the borders that Northeast India has are international borders. There is only 1% domestic border which is there, which is the Chicken Neck corridor, only 27 kilometer stretch by the help of which entire Northeast is linked to entire mainland India. So that is the only stretch which also gets disrupted when the Brahmaputra overflows or when there is flood situation in the Brahmaputra. So these are some of the issues which are there and which contribute to the problems of Northeast. So the issue is not just the tribal issues. There are so many tribes, as we talked about. There are more than 230 tribes which are active and which have different demands, different cultures, different traditions. So almost every tribe wants something special for their own people, right? So these are the problems which the government of India has not been able to accommodate till now. If we look at insurgency, there is not just DNLA who is active in Northeast. There are a lot of organizations. If I talk about Nagaland ke andar do bahut important prominent insurgent groups hain, NSCN-IM and NSCN-K. So NSCN-IM is the IM stands for ISAC and Muiva, which is a faction of NSCN which was developed, and the other faction is Khaplang. So these are two separate organizations which are active in Nagaland and supporting insurgency in Nagaland. Apart from that, if we talk about Manipur, People's Liberation Army and PRIPAC are two such organizations which are working against the government of India there. Assam, if we look at ULFA, is one organization which is very active and very aggressive and wants to use weapons to prove their point and wants to use weapons to put forward their demands in front of the government. And there is NDFB also. If I look at Northeast, these three states are the most disturbed states if we talk about Nagaland, Manipur and Assam. But having said that, it is also important to mention that a lot of good work has been done by the government itself. Like if we talk about Nagaland, there recently was a Naga Peace Accord which was signed by the PM Modi government in 2015 with NSCN-IM. So there has been an agreement that peace shall prevail in Nagaland. There has been recent Bodo Peace Accord which has been signed by the Indian government with NDFB. So there can be, we can see some kind of peace agreement happening in Assam also. So some good work has been done by the government. It is not correct if we say that the government is not doing anything. In Tripura also, National Liberation Front of Tripura is active. All Tripura Tiger Force is another insurgent group which is active in Tripura. In Meghalaya, we see two prominent organizations, ANVC and HNLC. So these are some of the organizations which are active and are demanding a lot of things from India. From Indian government, which the government is not currently able to accommodate. So these are the issues that surround Northeast, and these are the issues which make Northeast India such a troublesome area. Like the government has been trying to do a lot of things there, a lot of development activities are being done. There is a ministry for development for Northeast region specifically made so that this particular area can be developed, the socio-economic problems of these people can be taken care of, so that these people are integrated into the mainstream society. So this is it for today's lecture. I hope you enjoyed and gained something out of it. Thank you very much. Take care and bye bye. Thank you so much for watching this video. For more such videos, please keep watching this YouTube channel and subscribe to it. Thank you. Take care and bye bye.